Miami Imam openly plans for peaceful Islamic takeover of America. In a sermon that has ignited some debate, Miami Imam Dr. Fahi Kwabli Kabalwi. Sorry, my dyslexia. Kablawi provocatively outlines what he sees as the pervasive influence of Zionism, extending his critique to assert a broader geopolitical agenda. Speaking on January 26th at Masjid As-Sunna on Nabawiyah, North Miami, and it posted to Facebook, Kablawi charged Zionists with being sociopaths who, driven by self-interest, would exploit any group to further their aims. He stated, quote, "This is who they are, sociopaths. They would do that to any other person if they just reach a point that they are convinced that it is for their interests. By Allah, they will do it to anybody." His comments extend beyond a critique of Israeli policy to a controversial claim of a peaceful Islamic takeover of America, emphasizing conversion and the adoption of Sharia law in a future Muslim-majority United States. Despite the incendiary nature of his remarks, Kablawi insists on nonviolence, aiming instead for a religious and cultural shift through dawah, or the invitation, or, you know, preaching, evangelization of Islam to reshape American society from within. So, Armin, I forgot in the private chat, I put the link to the video, and I watched this morning, I watched his full Friday khutbah, so I can provide proper context, because people accuse, you know, memory, or they could also accuse us of like saying things out of context. So I watched his whole sermon so that I can report back to the Atheist Republic community about what's going on. And I would like to receive some thank yous, because I have to wake up in the morning and listen to first thing as I wake up.
Guys, tell Susie thank you for watching an entire khutbah so that when we watch 3 minutes of it, she has the proper context to make sure that this is not taking out of context. So tell her that you appreciate her doing that. Not all of us listen. How long was the khutbah? I hate listening to khutbah.
Like an hour.
Oh my God. Okay. People are saying, thank you, Susanna. All right. Thank you for your service. Thank you, Big Sus. Okay. Okay. Let's watch this.
Enemies of human beings, if they do it to the Palestinians in Gaza, they will do it to you if they need to. This is who they are, sociopath. They will do that to any other person if they just reach a point that they're convinced that it's for their interest. They will do it. They will do it to the Christians. They will do it to the Chinese. They will do it to the Americans. They will do it to the Germans. Wallahi akho, they'll do it to anybody. To anybody. With Muslims, they have extra reasons to do it, but they will do it to everybody. So that sign here on the Golden Glade, now when you leave, that Hamas or Hamas is what? It's not only your problem or something? It's not. It's your problem too. Hamas is your problem too. You see the language? My Hamas is gonna finish Israel and they're gonna start going to Europe and America. It's gonna take them a long time digging a tunnel under the Atlantic Ocean, dude. You know? But anyway, the idea is scaring tactics. It's your problem too. You know who the problem too? Your Zionism is the problem of the world. Take it from me. Go back and read their history, learn their history. Who did assassinations all over the world? Who blew up buildings all over the world? Who blew up American ships? Who did? Hamas? Or Mossad? Who blew up 9/11? Oh. And wallahi, ya akhwa, we have nothing to do with it. and they will see it. But they have to create scenarios like this so they can come and kill us. Most Americans are naive and have no clue. All they're worried about is the Super Bowl. Need to change that, and we need to propagate that and change it with people around us. Open your mind. We're not here to kill anybody. We're not here to hurt anybody. We don't want to take over your country. If we can, you know, I mean, we will take it, but in means that the law allows us. Here, we're going to make da'wah to the people. Like the guy who emailed me, some guy, Brad Jennings. Oh, do you want to Sharia laws in America? I said, if America becomes majority Muslims, then inshallah we choose to implement Sharia. Then he goes, go to Gaza. They need dental work. I said, there are enough dentists in Gaza. But I'm here so I can convert America. You know?
Armin, I need your immediate reaction. I'm dying.
So first he says, like, oh, Zionists want to take over America, the entire world, not us, and then proceeds to tell us that how he wants to take over America. Like, you don't need to worry about us. We don't want to take over everywhere. It's the Zionists that want to do that. By the way, then he goes and tells us, but when he says that we want to convert everybody in the United States to become Islamic majority country and then enforce Sharia, that means like stoning, executing infidels, chopping off hands. Don't worry, we will get there at some point, but we will do it through peaceful means. Do you know what that means? That we will become violent, but at first we will be peaceful. That's what that means. That's the translation. Exactly what Muhammad did. You know, the first phase of his, when you don't have the power, like they're like, we will be peaceful when we don't have the means to be violent. When we are not powerful enough to be violent, we will be peaceful. And then once we have the upper hand, once we are high in numbers, then we will enforce Sharia, which requires violence, which has violence in there. Like, you don't. So basically when he says, don't worry, he's talking about now. We will be peaceful initially at, you know, when we are low in numbers. Like that's exactly what that translates to.
Yeah.
When we're low in numbers. Yeah. When we're low in numbers, we will be peaceful. When we're high in numbers, we will enforce Sharia, which means like arresting people without hijab, executing infidels, chopping off hands and legs, flogging people, all of that. That's what he said. And he said, don't worry about us, just because at the initial phase we're going to be peaceful. I mean, he's like, yeah, only after we managed to change the laws.
It's just so crazy. Okay, so now that we saw that, I can provide more context about the rest of this sermon. Okay, so the sermon opens and he tells a story from the time of the prophet where there is some battle happening and there's someone who has to hold the battle standard flag and they get one arm chopped off and they keep going and they get the other arm chopped off and they try to keep going, but they can't. So then there was some dude who was in the army who didn't think that he was worthy or maybe originally became a Muslim out of pride or self-interest. And then they were like, it's your turn to do this. And he like rose to the occasion and carried the battle standard into battle and was like so important and blah, blah, blah. So then he compares that to the current day. And he's like, yes, and all of us are called upon to like act when we're in battle. All of us are called upon to act in battle. But like, what is that battle right now? And he's like, and one day we will have to, because one day there will be a final battle. And then he makes a very, very, very thinly veiled reference being like, and I will leave it to your imagination about who that will be against. And I'm like, oh, okay. So basically this entire khutbah is like barely veiled anti-Semitism. Like he tries to like do a little bit of euphemism. It's like barely there. And then he goes on to talk about how the real battle right now is the battle for consciousness, the battle of the consciousness, the battle of the mind. And their battle is won because they are on the side of truth, the only truth and the last truth. And one thing he talks about as an example of the battle of the mind, this is going to be very interesting to you, Armin. He gives us the example of the battle of the mind is an example of a soldier in the IDF that you covered a few weeks ago on this channel. This received a lot of attention. There was a Muslim soldier serving in the IDF, and he was killed, and he was buried with the Israeli flag covering his coffin. And there were photos of people, you know, giving the prayer of last rites or whatever to his coffin with the Israeli flag, like visible Muslims doing this. And it like broke the brain of so many Dawah guys online. And they're like, you're getting buried with the Zionist flag for killing your fellow brothers in Islam. What the fuck? And so this guy, this imam brings up the story of this soldier whose name I tried to find beforehand, but I couldn't find his name. And first of all, he makes several remarks about how he was so confused that this even existed. And then goes on to tell lies. So he's like, this is a Palestinian like man who was in the IDF, blah blah blah. I'm like, technically he's Arab, that's his ethnicity. He's an Arab Israeli who fought in the IDF, and he went to Gaza and he fought and he was killed. And but this, he keeps on referring to him as a Palestinian. And then he says, okay, so you live in Israel and then you have to serve in the IDF and you're forced to, blah, 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 and it's compulsory. And I bet he thought that he was doing a good thing, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, that's a lie. Israeli Arabs do not have to serve in the IDF. That's a lie. Israeli Arabs choose to serve in the IDF. For Israeli Jews, it's mandatory. But for Arabs, it's not.
Yeah.
And so I'm like, first of all, that's just not true. This is a man that chose to serve his country. And he gives this example of the battle of the mind because he's saying, you know, I bet that this man said that he was a Muslim as much as we say that we are Muslims. I mean, it's crazy to think about, just crazy to think about, I know. But, and, you know, a lot of people are saying that he's not a Muslim and all this stuff. But the battle of the mind is that he was serving his nation before he was serving Islam. So the example of the battle of the mind that he gives is basically a juxtaposition of civic nationalism versus holding your religious identity above all other identities and your allegiance to that above all other allegiances. And so this is the initial example he gives as the battle of the mind. And then he goes on to talk about like basically how Zionists are controlling the world and how in any other circumstance they will do whatever is in their interest they will screw over whoever as long as it's within their interest. And he gives this example of, he referenced this in the video clip that you just saw, and I'm going to give a little context for people that don't know. There is a like a public awareness campaign that's going on in a lot of different US cities. Some of them are against anti-Semitism in general, and some of them are about like Hamas or October 7th specifically. And so he's referencing one of these public awareness campaigns that's on a giant billboard outside of his city. And the billboard says Hamas is your problem too. So basically it's a public awareness campaign about Hamas and basically trying to communicate to people that this is not just a Jewish problem or this is not just an Israeli problem, right? And for people that don't know what that is referring to, like the ideology of Hamas is one of globalized intifada. globalized jihad. Even the leftists who love to say they're pro-Palestine happily chant in the streets, globalize the Intifada. Right. So it's that. So then he makes a joke and he said, oh, well, you know, they're going to have to dig a lot of tunnels to get to the Atlantic, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, you're not being sincere, are you? Are you really being sincere? It's not about literally digging tunnels. Are you dumb enough to think that that's really the only tool in their arsenal? Like, this is about the fact that they have a globalized Islamist ideology. It's a universalist ideology. So what do you, and you know that because you also want this to be globalized as evidenced by your sentiments.
Exactly.
It's like so dishonest.
Right.
So go ahead.
No, but and also Zionism isn't, because I don't know how these people define Zionism. They have turned Zionism into this like thing that has nothing to do with Zionism, something, this ideology that is taking over, trying to take over the world and control everything. And I like when people talk about Zionism like that, I ask them, like, can you define Zionism for me? Because to me, Zionism is just, you know, there are different variations of it, but the only core element that makes them all the same is the belief that Israel should be a thing, right? That's it, that Israel should exist. That's not a global ideology. The only time that it becomes influential in other places is when there are threats from other places. So when there are threats around the world to the existence of Israel, its core is only localized geographically on Israel. But like, yeah, we had assassins by Mossad going around and killing people around the world. But there were people who were killing Israelis. And Mossad sent agents around the world to eliminate that threat. There are people, there were terrorists that came to Israel and came to, you know, and killed a whole bunch of Israelis, assassinated them. You know, they used bombs and everything. And Israel did a very good job at going and finding these people and removing that threat, as they should.
A lot of them not are because, in the center of Iran.
Yes, but not because they're trying to take care of control all over the world. They're only trying to make sure that Israel can continue to exist. That's the only thing they're trying to do. I think it's projection. I don't know. You're trying to take over the world. As you say it openly, and as it's in your scripture. Like, show me the guide. Show me the Zionist ideology that is trying to take over the entire planet. It doesn't exist. You guys make that up. But within your own scripture, the scripture that you say you believe in, there's a mandate for you guys to take over the world. The Quran itself says that. Fight until all religion is Islam. All religion is for Allah. Everywhere in the world, it tells you to fight until you get there. So yeah, we should be fearing you. That's your ideology.
And then I just love how he ends being like, yeah, freaking Brad Jennings emailed me being like, what, you want the way he talks about Brad Jennings? You want to implement Sharia? What's wrong with you? And he's like, yeah, just not right now.
Is Brad Jennings like the version of other people saying like, Abdul called me? Like, right? Like, isn't that like the white version of that, right?
I guess so, yeah. Insert white man name. It's just so, I don't know. The lack of self-awareness is what really made me laugh about this one. And then when he was like, I mean, who did 9/11? Oh! Like, okay, dude.
Yeah. It's always the Jews, apparently.
Yeah.
Oh, speaking of, let's
that
see
is not our views, YouTube.
Yeah.
Algorithm gods, we are making fun of the views of other people. So, yeah. Ooh, we got a lot of super chats. How about we start going through those?
Yes. Let's do that.
Sid Rasika gave us a super sticker. Thank you, Sid. Noah also gifted 5 Atheist Republic memberships. Hey, thank you, Noah. If you just received an Atheist Republic membership, make sure to use your new emojis in the live chat.
Thank you.
And thank you for supporting. Welcome to Satan's Minions. And Sid, actually, well, let's go through these smaller ones first. Mithras Revisited also gifted a bunch of memberships. Thank you, Mithras. And Gaijin American gave a super chat saying, is this Seven Mountain Dominionism with Islam? So Seven Mountain Dominionism is a Dominionist conservative Christian movement within the Pentecostal church. It holds that there are 7 aspects of societies that believers seek to influence: family, religion, education, media, entertainment, business, and government. Basically. Mm-hmm. Wait, that's not correct. Wikipedia is not correct. There's, oh no, I can't count. The dyscalculia, I guess. Oh,
I was waiting for you to see that. Thank you.
Angel just gave us a $200 super chat. Holy mother. Thank you, Angel. Oh my God. Wow. That is so generous. Thank you, Angel. I'm blown away. Saying, so sad I missed last week. I hope everyone is having a good day. I'm having a great day. Thank you, Angel. I hope you are too.
Thank you, Angel. That was very generous. That's
insanely generous. Thank you so much. Wow.
Thank you.
So now we got a bunch of super chats by Sid Dave. So let's dig into these. Saying, if there were any sanctions against South Africa for apartheid and so many countries accuse Israel of apartheid, why are Muslim nations not accused of apartheid for their treatment of minorities? Only four Muslim countries, Turkey, Tunisia, Albania, and maybe Kosovo, allow marriages between non-Muslim men and Muslim women.
These are 4 different questions. I think we should address each one of them separately.
These first two are related.
Oh, okay.
So everywhere else it is totally banned. How is this not similar to Jim Crow laws? Well, my understanding is that miscegenation is supposed to be racially based, and there are lots of other, like, for example, Israel doesn't allow interfaith marriages, and I think that's a huge problem. And my understanding is that part of that has to do with a certain level of supremacy of religious law within the civic code, and I hate that. But okay, let's go back to the original question, basically being, do Muslim countries practice a form of apartheid against their minorities? And I think in many of them, yes. I don't know if it would be full. So there, I mean, obviously in Iran, there's a very easy argument for gender apartheid. Like, that's how many people refer to it. I think that there's a very solid argument for that. And I think it's also worth sharing that, like, what is and is not apartheid is, like, it's complicated. It's often up to a debate. I think that's a pretty easy argument to make. But Armin, what do you think about the argument of just apartheid against the minorities in general? I think there are many other instances where you can make a very easy argument for that.
Yes. I mean, in Iran, it's not ethnic apartheid, as even if the ethnicities are getting, sometimes they're getting oppressed more, it's mostly because of poverty rather than ethnicity in Iran. But I mean, these are words that you could, like, gender apartheid is a new term that we made up and it has utility, so why not? Let's go with it. Apartheid, like, by definition, you know, if people say, like, it's just the South Africa experience, some people just say that was apartheid and that's it. But if we could expand the definition to mean having 2-tier citizenships based on ethnicity, and we have that in some places. For example, in Turkey, we might have that against the Kurds, right? But again, why there is not as much of a backlash? Because for example, with gender apartheid in Iran, there has been a global backlash. I think one reason for why it's not as effective is because Iran has oil. So an economic sanction on Iran would not be as effective as there was on, you know, South. And there has been sanctions on Iran. So you could see that you see that happening. One reason why there is a lot more backlash against Iran, against other countries, is because the population there wants that from the international community. Why do you not see it in other countries like you saw it in South Africa? Is because a lot of civilians, a lot of the citizens of that country do want the discrimination. Like in a lot of Islamic countries, a lot of the people agree with the Islamic standards. And so the minorities, the oppression against the minorities in Islamic countries is mostly faith-based rather than ethnicity-based. So when we're talking about oppression of minorities, we're talking about religious minorities or people that have no religion at all. That's the form of oppression that you're going to see in Islamic countries more than oppression on specific type of ethnicity, and also on women and also on LGBT. So those are the type of oppression that you're going to, and they're only going to be a strong backlash when the people of that country demand the backlash. Like, for example, what you saw in South Africa was the people in that country, they wanted that international backlash. And the people in Iran, they want that international backlash from the internet. They expect that from the international community. So you saw a major international community because there was a call from between. It's not going to be as effective from Iran because the government in Iran has the oil and the, you know, that they could rely on. So they have some level of dependency that, you know, that they could do without the international trade, unlike South Africa could not have done that. But other Islamic countries, they might, especially the ones that don't have oil, they might not be able to afford to do that. But again, the people there are not asking for that. The people in Afghanistan, for example, a lot of them do want an Islamic government. The people in Yemen, unfortunately, for example, they do want an Islamic government. The people in Iran, they don't want an Islamic government. So, you know, you see a lot more international support for them against an Islamic government.
Where the other minorities that exist are like so small in number that they can't raise yes. either enough of a profile, or it's just frankly too dangerous for them to try to raise this movement within their own country itself. So like
that's a good point.
With Pakistan, I think it is so easy to argue that there are like so many different levels of apartheid within Pakistan. But are you going to be an Ahmadi trying to raise a movement in Pakistan? Hell no.
Right. That's another element that I didn't think about. That's very smart. Like in South Africa, the people who were doing the apartheid, they were the minority. On the, you know, compared to the people that they were doing the oppression on. So it was really easier for them to get international sympathy because they were able to mobilize and highlight these things, right? But in Pakistan, the people, for example, the minorities that the oppression is being on, they're the majority. So, you know, a lot of the people don't want to change the status quo because they're happy with it. And the minority that doesn't have enough of a voice to be able to raise, to get the international attention. But for the women in Iran, they are able to get the international attention because there's a lot of them. But again, that hasn't led to the toppling of the apartheid system against women, for example, because the Iranian government is a lot more powerful than the apartheid government in South Africa was at that point.
Yeah.
Because of oil. That's why oil is a curse sometimes. That's why we need alternative forms. We need alternative form of energy. You know, that will be a source of liberation for the Iranian people.
Hashtag go nuclear.
Or fusion.
Sid gave another super chat saying, Armin, I met an Iranian dissident in Ottawa who told me that Iranians have a historical score to settle with Arabs. Racist hatred against them, and that's why they are Shia, to use it against Sunni Arabs. Do you think that is the real reason behind the Shia Sunni split, Armin?
Well, the Shia Sunni split happened during the beginning of the Safavid dynasty, and it was when that happened, it was a form of differentiating Iran from the rest of the Ottoman Empire at that time. So one of its utilities was that. And a lot of people do consider that. I mean, but the Ottoman Empire at that time was Turkish. So the difference, Iran, the Iranian, you know, entity at that point tried to have a distinct form of Islam from the rest of the Islamic world to have its own unique identity. But initially, this started not because of Persian versus Arab. This was, at that time, the powers that be, when it comes to the Islamic world, they were Turkish. They were, it was the Ottoman Empire. But there has been a lot of anti-Arab hatred within Iran, unfortunately, for many, many years. And a lot of people do come up with that conspiracy theory for that's the reason. But I don't think necessarily that it's multifactorial. That might have played a role in there, because the Arab, there has been an irresistible, even though the Ottoman at that time, the main enemy of Iran was the Ottoman Empire, the Islamic identity was seen as an Arab identity, which was separate from the Iranian identity. And within Iran, from very ancient times, for a long time, there has been this push to keep a distinct Persian identity separate from the Islamic Arab identity. I mean, you can see, like, from even in the Shahnameh, which is the most, you know, one of the most famous Persian poetries, there is a constant, which is like there for hundreds of years. This is like a really, really old Iranian poetry book. There's a constant attempt in that book to not use any Arab words and just be purely Persian. The entire book was purely Persian, and a lot of people celebrate that book because of it. However, I'm happy to say that in recent years in Iran, the anti-Arab racism has been dying very rapidly. Right, there is this push for, even from among a lot of Iranians that are anti-Islam, to separate that from being anti-Arab. There has, even within the last 5 years, like when I was in Iran, the anti-Arab racism was so prevalent that even trying to push against it was seen as disgusting and somebody who's on like an Arab lover. Like I experienced that it was even bizarre to push against it. That's how normalized it was. But now in Iran, you could see that actually speaking ill against Arabs is turning into a taboo. And even people who are extremely against Islam, they want to separate that from being against Arabs. And through, like, for example, through our work, Atheist Republic, because we have a Persian show in Iran as well, that we have a Persian show that like a lot of people consume in Iran. Over the past couple of years, over the past 5 years, when I was like pushing against anti-Arab racism, I remember 5 years ago, I would get a lot of pushback. But now the people who are against me, and they are getting a lot of pushback. It's actually very, very taboo to among a lot of Iranians, even anti-Islamic Iranians. It's taboo now to be anti-Arab. And again, I'm very proud of the work we did, because I think we had a major influence as well. When it comes to our audience, and what one thing that we did, which was very effective, was introducing our Iranian audience to Arab atheists and Arab anti-Islamic Arab atheists. And a lot of Iranians are now celebrating. A lot of Iranians that are pushing back against Islam are celebrating fellow atheist, anti-Islamic Arabs, and they're now much more careful to make sure that in their anti-Islamic narratives, they don't push for anti-Arab, narratives as well, which is, we have made huge progress on that aspect in Iran. So I'm proud of that.
Yeah, because a very typical standard narrative used to be, well, we should be against Islam because this is not even like our culture. This is a foreign invasion, blah, 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 blah.
Yes.
Like, and then use it to denigrate other people instead of being like, part of that is true, but that's not actually why, that's not the best reason why you should not be a believer, right? Sid gave another super chat saying, in India, many Muslims have won gallantry awards fighting against Pakistani armies. Please read about Abdul Hamid, Major Hanifidum, who died fighting for India against jihadists based. Even Hindutva folks respect him. Hey, well, we love fighting Islamists. Secular Sakai is celebrating his 22-month membership, saying, well, another monthly dono promo soon help AR. When I get back from my trip, I'm going to be running some numbers. But thank you for checking in with me on that.
Yes. I think that would be a good idea.
Never really going to say no. Fahur is foul. Said, will Europe fall? The UK looks to be screwed. I ain't going to lie. I think the UK is screwed. I shouldn't laugh.
No, okay. So what do you mean by fall? Okay. Things are going to get worse. It's not going to fall. Okay. It's not going to be like the fabric of society is going to break apart. I think things are just going to get more conservative, you know, for both from the far right and from the Islamists. Things are just going to get more conservative. It's not going to be a Sharia takeover. It's not going to be like, you know, Islamic governments in Europe. That's not going to happen. But again, saying that's not going to happen doesn't mean that the things that are going to happen are not bad. Things that are going to happen are already horrible enough for we not having to exaggerate. Because if you exaggerate how bad things are going to get, then people are going to dismiss how bad things are really going to get. You know, so if we are, at position 100, and we are going to drop to 80, that's a very massive hit. And if you say that we're going to reach 2 and we don't reach 2, is people are not going to take seriously how bad things are when we go from 100 to 80. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's horrible. That's a horrible drop. So it's not going to be the fall of society. It's not going to be like chaos and Islamic takeover. It's not going to be Sharia courts, it's not going to be LGBT people executed. We're not going to have that. But talking about that makes people not care about how bad things are going to get, because they're going to compare it to how bad people are promising it's going to get, and not going to take, as long as it's not a full-on Sharia takeover, then apparently we're good. No, things are going to get horrible. It's just, by horrible, I mean everything's going to get more conservative. You know, liberal values are not going to be taken more seriously. We're going to have Islamism more influential in politics. We're going to have, because of that, wokeism more influential in politics. And because of all of that, we're going to have far-right ideologies also a lot more influential in politics. And that's already extremely horrible without a full-on Sharia takeover. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Sid Dave, give another super chat. Thank you, Sid. Saying, in Iran, if a non-Muslim converts to Islam, they inherit the property of the entire family, thereby encouraging conversions. Islamic supremacy is worse than white supremacy. This is barbarism. Yeah, I agree that Islamic supremacy is worse than white supremacy. I don't know if that's a hot take. But if you know your stuff, it's a pretty easy argument.
It's worse because it's a more viral virus.
Yeah. It is a powerful meme. Gaijin American gave another super chat saying, if the Russian Federation is dissolved, should homelands be made for Romani and Sami peoples?
No. No, yeah, we're not going to make nation. No. Here's the thing, guys. The era of nation building, okay, is over. Okay. We are going to maintain the borders that we have unless a country willingly comes to a decision that they want to do a referendum and peacefully, like, do something about, like, splitting their nation or bringing two nations together, peacefully doing that. Other than that, we're not going to mess up with the current borders that we have, and we're not going to make new nations, okay? Deal with it. This is what we have, and this is what we're going to go up. We don't want to mess this. We don't want to mess anything up, okay? We're not going to do that, okay? Everything is good. Don't touch it.
And with that, let's go to the, actually, you highlighted this. Oh. Do you want to address this?
Oh, yeah. Somebody is asking me, Armin, why don't you debate Yasser Nadim al-Wajidi? Guys, anybody who wants to debate me can contact me on Twitter. On Twitter, my DMs are open. Armin Navabi, search for that. DM me, and I will debate you, okay? And also, we got a super sticker. Did we highlight that?
Debate me, bro. I didn't see the super sticker.
Oh, here. This one. From Blue.
Thank you, Blue.
Thank you for the super sticker. I appreciate that.
Do you know who makes the most amazing, gorgeous, and other adjectives that I can't use here on YouTube? Blasphemous art ever? We do! And for some reason, we are giving it away for free. Download them now using the link in the description before we change our mind.